Hey everybody, Mr. J here, and we are back with another installment of Mr. J Plays Social Studies. So, today we're going to be talking about the Incas. While I'm going ahead and going to do all this random stuff in the shop and my quests, I'll go ahead and talk about, we'll go ahead and look at the start of the Incas. So, the Incas are actually a civilization based in the western coast of South America, which is a little bit different than when you look at the Aztecs and you look at the Mayans, who are both based in that Central America region from about Mexico till about Peru. Not Peru, a little bit north of Peru. A lot of bit north of Peru, actually. Mr. J does not know geography. Mr. J knows a little bit about social studies. But reeling it back one in, talking about the Incas, they are located in about what is modern day Peru. And their territory stretches from about Ecuador, about middle of Ecuador, till about the south of Chile, which stretches quite a bit of the Andes Mountains. So that's pretty cool. They live in the mountains. They're a mountain tribe. While we're going ahead and getting jumped into this game right here, the Incas had two major cities, one by the name of Cusco, not to be confused with Cusco from the Emperor's New Groove. Similar in terms of what the region we're talking about. But in Peru, the Incas also had a city known as Machu Picchu. So this is one of their most now well-known cities. At the time, it had actually been lost to the Spanish when they were trying to find them. The Spanish actually never found Machu Picchu, so it was actually known as the Lost City. We're gonna go ahead and find a place to drop. Looking like I'm feeling fencing fields. It's one of my favorite drops. I do like dropping there, just for the loot that I end up getting, as well as I end up finding a lot of flowberry there, which I do particularly. It's one of my favorite things that they've added. But that has nothing to do with the Incas. However, I'm gonna keep talking. Looking for a place to land. I don't see anybody else around me. Yep, got nobody. Don't know why I remarked. Oh, that's why. Just taking a look around before I land. Looks like a good place to land. So while I'm finding stuff, we're gonna talk about the start of the Incas. So the Incas actually, their civilization began a little bit before 1400, mostly as small tribes. They didn't have a defined ruler until about 1438. So up until then, they were mostly small tribes. A lot of the land that they had was coastal deserts, snowy mountains, fertile valleys, and thick forests. So what we know about the location is that they're based around the equator. South America, we know, is a warm climate area. Ooh, look at Jest. There's that flowberry I was talking about. I'm not gonna pick them up because I have my small shields. So, middle of the 1500s, the Incas had about 12 million people in their population, which think it's pretty cool. They're pretty big. I mean, they're a pretty big civilization. So, I mean, I guess looking at, there's the flowberry fizz I was looking for. I like that. Looking at how the Incas as a society functioned, they were very, I mean, initially they started very separated. So, because they were a separated society, they didn't have a central anything really. So they looked at changing that. One of the, look, some shots. Let's see. Gotta reload. But, oh, gotta defeat this snitching guy. Let me just miss all my shots here, though. There we go. Alright, Legion guy defeated. Let's go ahead and get the leap from Goku. Anyway, back to what I was talking about. The Incas were looking to have a centralized government. Not only that, but they were looking to centralize their society as a whole. So, how did they do this? Well, I'll go ahead and tell you. One of the first ways they did this was through Pachacuti. I'm probably pronouncing that wrong, but he is the first ruler of the Incan society. He ruled from about 1438 till a little bit over 1460, 1463 to be exact. So about 30, 20, oh, that's not math. 20 something years. Again, Mr. J plays social studies, not Mr. J plays math. There's shots over there, and I'm gonna go away from them. But he was the first one who looked at uniting the Incas as a society. And I mean, he really wanted to do this to create a unified Incan empire, but limit the power of those in power. Like mentioned before, the Incans were a lot of small societies that made up one civilization. There's a chest up there, but I can't get it. So what he did was he removed the village leaders. Each society had a leader for their village, and so he went ahead and basically told the leaders themselves that were there that they were no longer leaders, and he assigned the societies, well, the individual societies, leaders that he trusted and he could depend on. He assigned them to those small cities. There's somebody here. I need to pick that up. But what he also did was he decided that he was going to try and, there's a chest around here, where's that chest? There it is. Those footsteps? Footsteps. I don't know if they're above me. Alright, well, I'm gonna get this chest out there shooting. Let's go ahead and get this chest. Oh, got a person. Alright, let me just miss all my shots, ran right past him. And he has a shotgun and I have to reload. Well, I tried. Nobody said Mr. J was good at this. Well, I guess I'll hop into a new game now. Oh, it makes me feel better he couldn't kill a bot. Fantastic. Cool. Sick beans, dude. Sick beans. Or is it cool beans? Anyway, that has nothing to do with Incas. What he did was to educate the children from these small Incan villages. That's the word I'm looking for. Villages. Not societies, but villages. So he took a bunch of the children from each of the surrounding villages, and he educated them in their main city of Cusco, which was essentially just a hub of culture. They taught the children about the culture of the Incas, their history, their religion, the language, and more things about just being Incan. And then once they were old enough, they were sent back to their villages to pass on the Incan way of life. Let's see, we're gonna clear out another area, like the glacier. Forgot to, oh, there I go. I didn't think the bus driver at first. Let's choose a challenge. I think I'm gonna, we're gonna do vehicles. But they wanted to pass on their way of life, so the easiest way to do this was to start young. I mean, you start young, you educate children, and from there they pass on the way of life. Well, this could have seemed pretty hard at first. A lot of them spoke different languages. There was no centralized Inca language, so a lot of them had their own language per their village, which simply was not going to help. I mean, it's basically like trying to communicate with people who don't speak the same language. It's not going to work out too well for you. However, what they did in the city of Cusco was they actually created a centralized language. So when they taught the children about the Inca way of life, they're not Incans. The plural of Inca is Incas, which still trips me up every now and again. So I'll end up saying Incans instead of Incas, but it's Incas. However, moving on, they created a language and educated the children in this centralized language known as, I'm gonna torch this word too, but Quechua. Quechua was the centralized language that they all spoke in Cusco. That does not mean that they centralized this language between all of the Incas. It was just the language they spoke in the... There sounds like somebody next to me. Maybe I'm crazy. Maybe I'm crazy. I don't know. Oh well, gotta run. But this language was spoken in the main city of Cusco. They also taught about the different aspects of Inca society other than passing on education and power. Yeah, I'm just gonna throw this car in this lake right here. But the Incas had an academy system. This was how they I mean, justified their way of life. They had their own tax system, as well as labor system. With their tax system, the Mida, as it was called, like, that is the actual name of it, M-I-T-A, the Mida. Oh, somebody's been here. Would you look at that? Can't destroy the porta potty. But there's a chest up there. Anyway, I was talking about the Mida. This was their labor. This was their tax system based off of labor instead of money. And through the Mida, the government's basic, well, the Inca government basically controlled the economy and the households as one. And they were able to control what families were able to do and how they spent their time. So the Incas spent most of their time working for the government, but also used the other bit of that time working for themselves and providing for their own families. Somebody's been here. That is just a fish. So, anyway, making sure I don't get snuck up on. That would suck. Going up that zip line wouldn't help me because that's away from the storm. Towards the storm, away from the circle. I don't have anything to do. So we're gonna go. Oh, getting shot in the back. Where are they at? He's gonna snipe me. Hit your shots. Hit your shots, Mr. J. Yep, that won't help me. And, yep. One day. All right, anyway, moving back to social studies. The Incas were mostly farmers. They were craftspeople. They created pots and other pottery. They created art. But much of this was not bought or sold traditionally because they did not necessarily have a monetary system. Their system was, like I said, based off of labor. So, other tasks they did were they farmed. Most of the Incas, like I said, farmed for the government and themselves. So it was kind of like they provided for both at the same time. The Incas had to work in the mines, mostly to get resources. Remember, they're based in a cave, mountains. They're in a mountain, so there's gonna be mines and mountains. A lot of that stuff. A lot of the resources they got, gold, other. What am I doing? Other jobs, resources were all found in the mines. Wow, lost my train of thought there. But some of the other things that the Incas did were they made clothes and goods for the army. We're gonna go pretty close. Yeah. But they had to make clothes for the army, but then the men ended up serving in the army as well. And as mentioned before, forgot one thing. Like I said, they were craftspeople. They were also engineers. They ended up building their roads and bridges. Incas are actually more well known for a lot of their building techniques and strategies. Such as their brickwork and I such as their brickwork, because their roads were made out of brick. Wow. but again, this is doing these tasks, such as jobs, were actually how the Incas made money. Not money, but that's how they gained their well-being, pretty much. A lot of it was based off of their job. But this tax required each Inca to have some sort of job. Albeit they had to be of age now. Life expectancy during this time was a lot different than life expectancy now. So the working age was probably a lot lower. It was probably more around the age of 14, maybe even 13. These were probably more considered the age in which you would be required to get a job or have a horse start providing for your family. But the law was that each able-bodied Inca had to work a certain amount of days in a year. So that is a bot. Nice. I think that's my first Elam All episode. Cool. So it required them to work a certain amount of days in a year, and doing this would ensure that they would not have to find some way to supplement an income or try to pay for stuff to afford to continue to live where they live. Yes, a little bit more to go, at least for this video. I'm gonna talk about a little bit about the Inca religion, because similarly to other native religions, the Incas were a polytheistic society, which means they had multiple deities or gods, and each god had a different purpose. So the Incan rulers were actually said to the Incan rulers were believed to have been related to the sun god. I'm going to pronounce this wrong too. Inti, I-N-T-I. But because of this, the Inca rulers were thought to not die. I mean, they were said to live forever. So the Incas were actually a society that did mummification. So the Inca priests would actually take the mummies of Inca rulers to ceremonies, where they would be probably worshiping their gods or some kind of ritual. And at these ceremonies, the Inca ruler mummies would be given things such as food and gifts. Now, I don't know if any of you have seen a mummy or thought about trying to feed one, but I can let you know now. That was not smart. I can let you know now that it was probably not, an easy task to do. Like, if you're trying to feed a mummy who's wrapped up in cloth and other stuff. Don't know how much they'll do with food, but beside the point. This is what they believed in. So, like the. So, I'm in Aquarius, and. Yeah. Jumping off the mountain was probably not the smartest idea. Anyway, I'm not going to talk about it. Even though I did it twice. Mr. J Plays Social Studies is not a series about me being smart. Let me just start with that. But, like the Mayans, the Incas also held sacrifices. Oh, there's a person. The Incas also held sacrifices. Come on, Mr. J, hit your shots. Okay, almost there. There we go. Alright, so, anyway. The difference between the Incas and their counterparts, the Mayans, and even the Aztecs, is the Incas did not sacrifice humans. Well, or if they did, it was very rare that the Incas sacrificed humans. Most often, they would sacrifice food, whatever foods they made, that is a fish, foods they made, whatever clothes or jewelry they had. Usually these were precious minerals or other resources, and they would sacrifice the llamas. Now, one thing we should note about the Incas is llamas were actually very important to them. This is how they did a lot of their moving, and this is how, I mean, it pretty much was like the modern day horse or donkey. They did a lot of, I'm getting shot at. They did a lot of things to help the Incas, but I'm gonna finish this gunfight off. Let's find out where this person is. They're definitely to my left. They've got to be to my left. So I'm going to run, try and get high ground on them. Oh, found them. And they are way more prepared. Okay, well with that, we're going to go ahead and end this episode for the day. But that was Mr. J Plays Social Studies, part 1.